Okay, up next we have Candace Renee Perkins. Candace has a degree in philosophy from the University of Oregon and is a novice poet, predominantly in the Eugene community. Her writings are relatively aimed at short story audiences, but a newfound opportunity as a live performing poet have found way into her radar and may be a possible future path. Other hobbies include reading, philosophy, and popular youth novels for giggles, cooking for her partner to cope with unemployment, and playing video games to overcome personal existence. Please welcome Candace Renee Perkins.
I'll only say fuck once, twice, and I will not mention sexual things. So I'm only going to do two in respect to your time. My first one's called Slasher Film Moments. Attention, this poem is rated R for violence, sexual undertones, language, and other adult content. Lately, life for me has become so similar to a B-grade slasher film that I have lost both my sense of comfort and my mind. It all begins in a state of an existential crisis and loss, where one day all daily expectations of life are lost to the blatant matter-of-fact knowledge that the world is not concerned with me and never will be. This echoes for me the opening scene of many films that begin at once with a group of four high school teenagers going camping, or a small suburban family on a road trip so dad can take a new job in another city. See, these people are always bound to fail to reach their destination, either by never reaching it entirely or being forced to revise their plans due to traumatic events. The paper map dad packed is hard to read because the rain is falling too hard, or fucking Google Maps has lost you on a street that apparently does not exist. So logically, they search for help, finding a seemingly abandoned cabin in the woods or a small hick town with most of the buildings closed or shut down permanently. Metaphorically, this is man's claim to false hope. Someone's head always says that, yes, this mess is temporary, and now that civilization has been spied, we are saved, and it will all be over soon. As audience members, we sense the inevitable wrongfulness of the situation the moment we see the creepy motel owner or the hillbilly brothers approach the lost wanderers. A false sense of calm turns quickly into a game of foreshadowing despair as the camera angles bend to become the eyes of the killer, and the temporary loss begins to turn into everlasting agony. Friends and family begin to disappear, and gut instinct says flee, leave. But they can't because the car they took to be here has been tampered with. What better way to capture the ultimate despair of being trapped? Within a shady town, your own skin, a situation so unknown and full of so much anxiety. Then come the bodies. Beheaded, stabbed, violated, mangled. Gruesome sights that will turn your stomach into itself and make you wish you never left the safety of your foyer. The look of the world is not only uncaring, but presented as cruel. Some sixth sense set of space and time full of horrific sights raging from disease and tragedy, and the worst is yet to come. The world eventually comes after you. The killer eventually comes after you. He has knocked off most of our companions, the people we are rooting for to escape, and all are left ready to leave the world the same way we all came in, utterly alone. It's kill or be killed, and either outcome will cost dearly. The killer comes from the shadows and robs them of their lives, decapitates, violates, and empties their bodies till they are but hollow versions of their old selves. Hollow shells of former selves robbed of the safe return home, the promise of a camping trip with friends, or a new job for one's father. The journey has ended. Or let's say they bested the killer. They stabbed, violated, disfigured the body of their greatest harm. What have they done? Could they wash the memory of that event that has occurred off their hands and face? Sure, they had to do it, and yes, they survived to find a truck driver 3 miles away who will pick them up and take them to real safety. exactly how, like how you once overcome your depression towards the world and said, I won't let my lack of purpose destroy my will to live. You return to a real sense of safety in your own situation. But after such an event, you can never go back to the way things were. You will be changed for the rest of your life and be hollow and cynical. But when you watch the last survivor drive away, scattered, scathed, and bloody, do you ever wonder what the first few days of their new life will be like? Thank you.
Woo!
Okay, this will be my last one. I wrote this one actually this morning in the gym. I was in a weird place this morning. I'm always in a weird place. This one's called Navigating the Transition. Alright, my phone like keeps dimming out after like 4 seconds. From all four corners of the world map, there lie difficulties in navigation and transition surrounding the basic structures of our own ideology and history. Time and space both complicit in what it means to be where you are to where you are going completely capture the foreground of the question of how do we get there? A question only appreciated in its entirety by captains of ships at sea and planes in flight that see that the how is a matter of safety and adventure. In mathematics, we can assure ourselves that the shortest distance between two points is a straight line, and that if Tom has two apples and eats one, that he will be left with but one. However, mathematical calculation notoriously dismisses the concept of chance, the idea that if I can't explain why it is, then it is but by cosmic accident that exists, or that it happened, and I myself remain blameless. What a laughable excuse for how forces greater than ourselves can act outside of our understanding of them. An utter failure in epistemology if I've ever seen one. Have you been told the story of Icarus and how the tragedy struck him down from the sky to the sea, all while his father watched in horror as his son capsized beneath the water and was thrown mercilessly into the rigid cliffside repeatedly? Do say he failed due to scientific ignorance, the disobeying of one's parent, divine intervention. We are correct to say that it was a lack of patience, for his failure was out of simple disregard for the correct means of how man might escape from a stone tower high in the clouds. Had he heard the story of Rapunzel and her hair, he might have discovered that man was meant to walk or climb, not to swim, nor to fly. Sure, we are told the cautionary tale now as a matter of historical dominance, but the moral of most of these stories is often brushed aside by an explanation of the fatal irrationality of the hero. But none can work within the productive guidelines of the rationale without losing at least, in part, the sense of creative ingenuity that allows us to rise and adapt to our most primitive situations. Einstein famously severed that war between art and science so that we would not lose the ability to navigate that in-between space, that in-between time of transition that it's so often seen, that in-between time of transition that so often is seen as the part we should be rushing through. I feel that the most charismatic and virtuous people make the greatest villains in fiction and reality, all on the account of this. Is there much of a difference between World War II's Hitler and Napoleon from Animal Farm? Didn't they want what they thought was most correct, most good? And didn't they tell wonderful stories to their friends of what the world could be if their desires came true? Why does it take so long for the heroes to ask how these achievements were to be done? People are always too late asking questions. Of course, I do not praise these figures for their actions or their determinations. My demand is that you look at the line between where we are and where we want to be, not the points themselves. Thank you.
Woo!
Thank you very much, Candace.